Welcome. You are about to take a journey to a place of the divine love within with Deborah Beauvais on the Love by Intuition show. For the next hour, allow her to prepare you in becoming a magnet for a profound love-infused relationship by identifying and focusing on solutions through love. Awaken the light within and let your essence shine. And now, here's Deborah Beauvais on Love by Intuition, all part of the Dream Vision 7 radio network.
Welcome, everyone. Bonjour, mes amis. And yes, here I am, Deborah Beauvais, founder and owner of the Dream Vision 7 radio network. We are also the proud media partner for the Omega Institute in Rhinebeck, New York. And if you're listening for the first time, check us out. We are all about uplifting the human race, helping people go within, find their demons or release them, all the different layers that we do with the work we are here experiencing on Earth. So we have an amazing guest welcoming back. I love his books. They're raw. They're shocking. They have such depth. They're enlightening. Everything that you'd want in a book is the way he writes, and you really put yourself right there in that space. So I'm welcoming Mark Matousek. He is author, this is his first book, Sex, Death, Enlightenment, A True Story. It's a classic memoir, a gay man living in fast-track life in New York City, working for artist Andy Warhol and back in the day, escapes India, confronts his demons, and takes the reader on a roller coaster ride to realize his dreams and discover the true meaning of life and holiness. He is also a blogger for Psychology Today. He's a teacher and speaker on creativity and growth using the Writing to Awaken method. He's written for The New Yorker, The O Magazine, so many of these good writings. And so without further ado, Mark, welcome to the show.
Thanks, Deborah. It's good to talk to you again.
Yes, thank you. And I have to say, the books are just, you know, I read a lot of books, and yours are so descriptive, and it invites you in right like you're right beside you. That's the only way that I can describe it. And so I find myself locked into the book until it's actually completed, which is, I think, what any author would dream of, correct?
Yes, I was just going to say that's what every author wants to hear, is that you can't put the book down. Makes me happy. If you don't connect to the reader, then you're doing a monologue. You're not having a dialogue, and I'm really interested in conversing with the reader in my books.
Yeah, so you were brave back in the day in your 20s to actually write about your journey, your childhood, and all of that. What compelled you, because again, this is the first book, what compelled you to write in this way and about your history?
I didn't have much choice, honestly, Deborah. I was a born writer, and I've been writing since I was a kid. And I had gone through some experiences that were so challenging and confusing, and also had such intrigue to them that I wanted to put them down on paper so that I, first of all, I could understand what had happened, and also being able to show other people that if experiences like this could happen, spiritual experiences and opening to what you would call the divine or the presence, then they really could happen to anyone. When I wrote Sex, Death, and Enlightenment 25 years ago, you know, I was an agnostic atheist, a cynic living in New York City and climbing the corporate publishing ladder, and I crashed. And thank God, I crashed, and I needed to get off get off the wheel and figure out who I was. While friends were dying of AIDS and everything was suddenly up for grabs, I left New York and I started a spiritual journey, and I felt compelled to write about it because I had not read a book like that. This was before Elizabeth Gilbert. This was before Eat, Pray, Love. I hadn't read a book about spiritual life for worldly people. And that's what I really wanted to write. I wasn't interested in just preaching to the choir. I wanted to speak to people like myself who were very skeptical, very doubting, but couldn't deny the mystic connection. So that's why I wrote the book.
Do you see the parallels with AIDS and the COVID?
Yes and no. There are parallels in the sense that one day you're living what you think is a normal life, quote unquote, in the normal world, and the next day everything has changed. Everything is turned upside down. You know, HIV/AIDS had that kind of an effect on those of us who were in those communities. But what isn't similar is that this is global. This is not that HIV wasn't, but this is really everyone dealing with impermanence and fear, isolation, these issues at the same time. So in that way, it's quite different. The bottom line, though, is the same: is that what happens when you realize that life is impermanent, and you don't have forever, and the things you took for granted as being assured and secure are completely not. You know, what happens? What happens to a person's mind? How does that move you towards spiritual practice? How does it open your awareness when the things that can fall away have fallen away, and there's something left that you weren't familiar with before? And that's what happened with me way back when, and it's happening for a lot of people now. You know, realizing if there's a side of themselves that they haven't nurtured or cultivated or even perhaps recognized. We don't live in a culture that promotes self-awareness or self-inquiry. And so we really need to have ourselves shaken up and have the familiar taken away from us before we are willing or interested in turning toward the mystery and the depths of who we are.
Right. Beautifully said. Do you feel that? Do you believe that there's a higher purpose to all of this, a higher meaning?
I gravitate away from higher, lower, because it can be very hierarchical and binary. I think that there is an absolutely essential meaning, which is that we are being invited to know ourselves and recognize the nature of reality. It sounds like that's an epic thing, but we really are. We live in such a trance of denial about the human condition and what's really going on in this world in terms of impermanence and what we take to be real. That having this opportunity is a radical thing. It's radical that so many people are looking at the possibility of spirituality, of moving beyond material things at the same time, so that there can be a kind of critical mass. And I think if there is an essential meaning or a meaning, a way that this can be turned to the good, it's absolutely around recognizing our spiritual identity. And that's what happens when life throws you around and takes things away from you, is you're forced to ask yourself, what is that thing that can't be taken away? And what one discovers in crisis, catastrophe, times of disaster, one realizes that there is a self, there's a sense of self, and an awareness that nothing can touch, that COVID can't take away, HIV can't take away, bad governments can't take away. It's who we are. And when we tap into that, it's the source of our well-being. So people are being called on to discover a source of well-being that can't be taken away by today's headlines or taken away by the next surge or whatever it happens to be. You know, people want a deeper sense of self, and that's what this pandemic is inviting us to discover.
Yeah. It makes me think of in the book Horatio, you were, I think it was towards the end, you went to work in a hospice hospital, and that rawness of seeing people wither away and in such pain, and I could feel Horatio was dying, and yet you brought the rose and you could see his light, and the light went beyond his body. And to actually experience and witness that must have been so phenomenal.
It was phenomenal. And anyone who's worked in hospice or who's spent time with people who are dying can attest to the fact that as the body goes, very often the spirit shines brighter because there's less of a veil. The physical veil is falling apart, and the spirit shines through. And people truly become who they are when they're dying. So if you've been a fearful, shut down, not self-aware person, that is how you're going to go out. But if you're someone who, like Horatio, has done deep work, at the end you're able to harvest that practice. And if you've touched a deeper joy, which he had done, you still have access to that even when the body is falling away. So when I brought in this rose in the ICU when he, shortly before he died, his face just absolutely glowed, and it was like he was transported by the beauty of it. And it taught me a big lesson about what can't be taken away. That as long as we have awareness, as long as there's breath, and as long as there's a willingness to move past the small self that is falling away, then extraordinary discoveries are possible right up until the end.
Yeah. It reminds me of the Holocaust, where people still had their dignity regardless of what was going on and still had their light glowing in ways that, like Viktor Frankl, in ways that many of us wouldn't understand under the circumstances.
Right.
But that light
Exactly. He called it the last of the human freedoms. The last of the human freedoms to choose our response in any given set of circumstance, that everything can be taken away from us but that.
Right. And that's really...
Go ahead, sorry.
I'm sorry. Go right ahead.
No, you go.
Thank you. That's really what it's all about. When you think about it, it's getting to the core of knowing that your light, your being is going to continue regardless of what is done to you, regardless of what has happened. You continue on, but you still have that dignity. No one can take no one can take your thoughts out of your mind. No one can do certain things.
Right.
When you think of it at that level.
That light too. You can express that light.
Yes.
And you're aware of it, and you can also express it toward others. Frankl talks about seeing the men who were on their way to the gas chamber who were wandering around giving away their last piece of bread. And that's when he had his epiphany that even in the worst, one generosity is possible. The heart doesn't have to die because the body is going. We can still stay alive and stay connected and be vital up until the last.
So let's talk about for a minute the atrocities done by the human hand. I spend time thinking about that and thinking, I know we have free will, but it amazes me that the human, and I know that we have the light and dark and all of that, however you want to call or talk about, but it blows my mind that the abuse that goes on for many of us in childhood and how that person can actually do certain things. And yet, we're either the abused or the abuser when you think about that. Most people, it's interesting that we're all sane.
Well, we're not.
So, I mean, where my thoughts are, and I have spent time thinking, how can people do certain things? I understand the whole, if one believes in reincarnation, one would believe that they would be on the other side of the situation. But do you ever consider how the human can do these things? And it's not just now, it goes back from day one.
Well, I absolutely do. In fact, I wrote a whole book about it. It's called Ethical Wisdom, and it's about what makes us moral animals and the fact that we are hardwired to make moral choices through biology. It's a survival mechanism, and we have certain areas of the brain, certain notes that the brain hits around ethics, morality, conscience, that help us survive, not only individually, you know, but as groups. The fact is that we, as Simone Weil said, I contain within myself the seeds of all possible crimes. You know, we all have the possibility, the potential for doing tremendous evil, as well as the possibility of tremendous and sublime love and goodness. And that's what makes us so fascinating and challenging as beings. But nothing changes until we recognize the entire spectrum of possibilities. This is really important, and that's why, folks, we all need to do our shadow work and understand the parts of ourselves that we would rather not look at. Because until we do that, we can't be wise. And there's no holistic living unless we acknowledge that we, too, could, in certain circumstances, behave abhorrently and in cruel ways. To the degree that people deny that, they hold on to self-righteousness, they stay in the story of self and other, oh, I could never do that, and they separate themselves from not only an essential part of themselves, but other people. So it's important that we turn around. You know, the word catastrophe comes from the Greek for to turn around. It's very important for us to turn around and recognize that we have not only this daylight face that we show the world, we also have a nocturnal shadow part as well. And there's no shame in that as long as we aren't afraid to look at it. Because until we do, nothing transforms. A wise man said to me once that we can't transform what we haven't first blessed. So until we have blessed even our cruelty, even our ignorance, even our hatred, until we can accept that it's there, nothing can change. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, exactly. And I agree with you. It's just hard to fathom. And yet, if you actually do past life regression and different things, and even sometimes you don't, once you're... have the awareness, memories can pop in, and you remember that each of us is pure and innocent, and exactly what you're saying. And I see that as just sometimes it's like, wow, how can that possibly happen? It's, you know, you'd think, well, if it was an alien or someone from another, you know, someone else in the multiverse or whatever, you could wrap your mind around that, but it's not. It's the same species. So yes. My next thought of that would be, do you find it fascinating that people can be in this darker side, in this heavier side, and there are others that are supporting them? I mean, and I find that fascinating. You know, there can be lies and threats and atrocities done to women, to the LGBTQ population, black and brown, democracy, all of that. And some people can still support the mindset of that.
Absolutely.
Do you find that fascinating?
Oh, I do. And there's a great book called Hitler's Willing Executioners, and it's about the people at the time of the rise of the Third Reich and Hitler, who stood by and did nothing, and realizing that doing nothing is collaboration. You know, doing nothing is giving our assent. There's a quote, I'll get it wrong, but I paraphrase, that the only thing evil needs to survive is for good men to do nothing. So you're completely right, and we've seen that, of course, in our country with the politics of our country, and we're also seeing it in terms of the COVID epidemic, you know, and people who know better are allowing the propaganda of wearing no masks, et cetera, to go forward for their political gain, when they know very well that they are, you know, they're signing the death certificates of untold numbers of people by not taking the side of the good and affirming what they know to be true. So that's the real sadness, and it's just, a lot of people feel this. It's the sadness of seeing good people stand on the side and not say anything and not do anything. That's what's hard to take.
Yes, I agree. Well, we're coming up on a break already. Would like to put out Mark's website. You can get in touch with him. Matousek is M as in mother, A T as in Tom, O U S as in Sam, E K as in kind. Mark is M A R K. MarkMatousek.com. And I've read two of the books, and I saw the ethical one. I'm going to get that as well because I enjoy the reading, and one learns so much about themselves as well. So stay with us. We'll be back more with Mark Matousek.
Experience a different yet profound healing with Reconnective Healing. Includes yet expands beyond any and all known forms of energy healing. The Reconnective Healing Spectrum is comprised of the full healing and evolutionary continuum of energy, light, and information. It allows for healings that are not just physical, not just mental, not just emotional, yet go beyond that to bring healing that includes the evolution of your very being and essence. Deborah Beauvais, trained and certified by world-renowned Dr. Eric Pearl, offers appointment hours at Seekonk Family Chiropractic in Seekonk, Massachusetts. For questions or to set up both distance or local sessions, call Deborah at 508-431-1959. Again, 508-431-1959. Or go to lovebyintuition.com. That's lovebyintuition.com.
Take a journey to a place of the divine love within with Deborah Beauvais on the Love by Intuition show, Monday through Friday at 6 p.m. and 6 a.m. Eastern. Our message is love in the purest form. The light within us all is a guide to recall our beginning, to learn to love self and humankind, and to feel the higher power of our own divinity. To attract love, one needs to be love. Come join us and step into this glorious vibration called love.
After narrowly surviving the attack on Sandy Hook Elementary, first grade teacher Caitlin Roy DeBellis was left searching for answers that would never come. Eventually, she chose to focus on questions that could be answered. How do I make sure this tragedy doesn't define us? How do we get our control back? Those two questions led her to found the 501c3 nonprofit organization Classes for Classes. When gifts poured into their classroom, she decided they would help someone else by paying it forward and being kind. This developed into a social network which allows K-8 classrooms to connect so that every student in the United States can learn these crucial lessons. Classes for Classes' mission is to build students' social-emotional intelligence by connecting them to care. All C4C projects are crowdfunded. Any teacher in the U.S. can visit classesforclasses.org. That's classes, the number 4, classes.org. Sign up today.
Delight your kids with an enchanting journey by reading the Paper Doll Kids children's book by Deborah Beauvais and Janine Sullivan. There's even a catchy tune, Kids for Love Song, produced by Bob Sherwood and sung by kids just like yours. The story weaves around 7 paper dolls flying around the world doing good deeds as they bring important attention to our endangered animal friends. There's even a magical ring with a universal message. Kids become interested in service projects, action through compassion, and planting seeds that nurture positive change. The Paper Doll Kids and Kids for Love Song are a production of the Kids for Love Project. Get the book now on Amazon Kindle and the song on CD Baby or iTunes.
Looking for a fun and relaxing getaway? Omega Rest and Rejuvenation Retreats are a great way to unwind and renew your spirit. You can stretch your body, quiet your mind, and do as much or as little as you choose. Join us in May and we'll waive the daily fees. Located in Rhinebeck, in New York's beautiful Hudson Valley, Omega's natural environment and quiet pace allow for extraordinary experiences to unfold. Learn more at eomega.org or call 877-944-2002. That's 877-944-2002.
This is Dream Vision 7 Radio Network, uniting mankind with universal love. Our shows are created from the heart, bringing each listener to a place of divine enlightenment. Breathe, relax, and enjoy. Let life flow. flow.
And welcome back. You're listening to our conversation with author Mark Matousek. And again, if you would like to, well, you can get his books just about anywhere in the universe. His website is markmatousek.com. Matousek is M-A-T-O-U-S-E-K, Mark with a K, markmatousek.com. This is a live show, and Bob is in the house, so feel free to give a call if you have a question for Mark or a comment. The number here is 833-220-1200. Don't be shy and just remember that the time flies by. So, Mark, I have to say that I just really liked Alexander Maxwell. I really felt him the way you were describing him, and sure, we all have our idiosyncrasies and all, but I just enjoyed him. And he's really the catalyst who got you started in going to India and Mother Mira, correct?
Yes, Deborah. Meeting him changed my life. He was the first person who told me that I was having a spiritual crisis. Now, I knew I was unhappy. I thought that I was depressed. I had this great job in New York, and I was supposed to be doing, I looked like I was doing well, but on the inside I was not doing well. And the first time he saw me, he said, "You're having a spiritual crisis," and it changed everything for me. I didn't think of the spiritual context of anything in those days, and it gave it a much deeper meaning for me. And I realized these were existential questions that were bothering me. It wasn't about just changing my job. It wasn't about just rearranging the furniture of my life. It was about asking myself who I was, because I had no sense of who I was. And he was the mentor who opened the door to that whole world for me. He started to give me books. He invited me to come with him to India. I quit my job. And on the way to India, he said we were stopping to see a friend of his. He didn't tell me anything. And we went to Frankfurt. We were picked up at the airport in Frankfurt. I knew nothing about what was going on. And we were driven to a small town an hour outside of the city called Talheim. And I walked into the house where Mother Mira was giving her darshan, her blessing, and had my mind blown off of its hinges. I had never experienced anything like that. I was completely unprepared, and I started to have quite amazing inner experiences that I couldn't explain. And it really was my first big taste of mystery. And what happens when the mind runs up against something it absolutely cannot explain? And as I said earlier, I have a hard head, and I'm a skeptic, and I'm a very doubting person. So what happens when someone like that runs into a paranormal experience or a spiritual experience that defies logic and reason? It changes you. It forces you to recognize how little you actually know and how little you truly understand, which is a great blessing. It's uncomfortable, but it's also a big opening and a big opportunity to let go of the stories of who one is and figure out the truth about identity, about our connection to God, about what's possible in terms of human awakening and liberation. All of these things start to happen when you have a sense that it's possible. And I didn't have that before I met him and before I met Mother Mira.
Hmm. Are you still in touch with him?
Yes, I am. Mm-hmm.
Good.
Yes.
Good.
Yes.
Good. Yeah. I think that's a good thing. I bet he's a really good friend now that you have, come away from everything.
He is, and the other thing, he is a very good friend, and particularly because he's a seeker. I find that my seeker friends are my deepest friendships. People who share a desire for the truth, who want to go beyond the obvious answers and experience their lives at a different depth. Those are the friendships that are the deepest and the longest lasting.
Right.
If I don't have that in common with folks, I find, particularly as I get older, there's less affinity. We just have less in common. And Alexander and I share that deep seeker spirit. And that's why I think our friendship has survived all these years.
Right. Good. And, you know, as far as, do you really feel that one has to awaken to spirituality to function in the world today?
To function? No, I think you can function,
well, not
to, but I don't know.
That's
that
probably
you can
the wrong term.
Yeah, I don't think you can thrive. You can survive, but you can't thrive.
Thank you.
There's the world is too dangerous and too dark and too scary not to have some kind of spiritual awareness to balance it out, to give it context, and to be able to maintain some perspective on the horrors of the world. So it's not about denying anything that's going on. It's about seeing them against a bigger backdrop and recognizing there is material reality, physical reality, can't be denied, but it's not everything. There is also metaphysical reality that's beyond what we can see. And when you get that, it's incredibly inspiring, particularly when you're threatened physically, as we are now with this disease. You know, when you realize that the body isn't everything, that there actually is something beyond just the state of the physical organism, it gives you resilience. It buoys your spirits. It gives you hope.
Yes.
In all those years when I was on the seeker's path, when I first quit my job and I thought that I might be not around for much longer, and I really was sort of driven to the edge by the fear of death. And what I found at that edge was a different kind of life. And it was a life that was grateful for the day. It didn't take anything for granted, and it had a deeper sense of meaning to it. So I wouldn't have gotten there had I not had my life threatened. And of course, this is common. You know, the Buddhists say that, you know, that contemplating mortality and impermanence is the fast track to enlightenment, and we all know that that's true. It either drives you underground into fear and you end up in a bunker, or it drives you to discover a new way of living with this awareness. And
right.
Back to your question, the only way to do that, in my experience, is with some kind of spiritual consciousness and sense
right.
of sense of the greater whole.
Yeah, and when you have that, for those that may not be on the, you know, have not on the, we're all on a path, but they might not be aware of their path. But when you have that spiritual connection and you have that gratitude for just a slight breeze on a very hot, humid day, when you experience that, it's the richness of that that gets you through the times that you experience that may be darker, heavier, and all. Without that, you know, you're really stuck in fear 24/7 that something is going to get you, whether it's this or that, it's coming for you. Do you know what I'm saying?
I agree. Yes, of course. I know what you're saying. It makes you grateful to be for your life, for your existence, full stop. So it doesn't.
Yes.
You don't need anything. It's not that you're happy all the time. It's not that bad things don't happen. But even on the worst day, you're glad to be here. There's a gratitude because you know how unlikely it is that you still are, how what an extraordinary and precious and rare thing a human life is. So that, like you say, even on a terrible day, bad things might be happening, but a breeze, you know, blows across you and cools you, and it cools you in a moment, and you have a sense of connection with the universe, and it alters that feeling of being closed in and hopeless and all alone and alienated, which so many people, particularly in this culture, suffer from these days, that kind of soul sickness that a lot of people talk about. It's important
right.
to have that. If we don't have that other awareness, I don't think it's possible to thrive. And it doesn't have to be religion. It doesn't even have to be spirituality per se. You know, I know many artists who are agnostic or atheist, and they're full of joie de vivre. They're full of, you know, gladness for being here. They find their connection to the divine through their work. You know, Mother Mira, someone was asked, she was asked, you know, what about an atheist? What do you say to an atheist who has no faith or belief in God whatsoever? And she said, everyone believes in something. And I think that's
right.
true. Whether it can even be love. There's a great story about Ramakrishna, the Indian saint. Someone came to him and said, I have no sense of God. I can't connect to the divine in any way in my life. And he said, who do you love? And he said, oh, I love my granddaughter. He said, love your granddaughter as God. You know, see God in her. And that's how he found his way to his faith. So it's about finding what we love and what has value for us and recognizing that that's our conduit to the divine.
Mm. Seeing God in everyone. Yeah, and so one time you mentioned somewhere along the way that our culture has lost the sacredness. Do you feel that now in this day and age?
Deeply. I feel it deeply. And this is a big question, and this we're talking about an epic, E-P-O-C-H, that needs to shift. We live in the age, in the information age of scientific materialism. That's our religion. And so what we're doing here, what seekers are doing, what spiritual practitioners are doing, is really the minority approach. The vast majority believe that believe in duality, believe in, you know, that this is my mind inside my body, and believes in, you know, self and other. And so that's the prevailing view. And it's going to take time for that to shift. I do think a new consciousness is being born. And mm-hmm. there's a lot of adversity as well. So it's going to take time. But I do think that if we survive, then we can evolve into a new way of being. I see it in people around me, whether they're religious or spiritual people or not. I know that transformation is real and that it can happen, but it takes time, it takes attention, and it takes us turning away from the baubles of life and pursuing, you know, just, you know, superficial pleasures or pursuing material success. We have to be turned away from that somehow before we take that other journey. And it's not a move that most of us make voluntarily. We tend to need some kind of a crisis or disaster to knock us, you know, off our pins in order to gain a new perspective. Do you agree?
Absolutely. And it's interesting when you get down, you know, from everyone has personal experiences, when you're down on your knees and you're just, you know, you're just surrendering everything, including your being. That's the most sacred place that you can be, because, and then it's so freeing. Everything that's heavy or painful goes away in that moment.
And that's, for example, Deborah, that's what a lot of people don't understand about working with a guru, for example. They see you bowing down in front of a guru, and they think that that's a power trip. They don't recognize that the actual guru-disciple relationship is that they are reflecting back what is in us. And when we bow before them, for example, that's not a power trip. That is a sacred connection, and recognizing the sacred is what a guru's job is, or what any teacher's job is, and that's what we need to do. We need to move toward the awareness of what we are beyond the body, you know, or else this species may have a bad time on its hands. It's about connecting to nature, recognizing the divine in nature and ourselves. The more we move in that direction, the more we're going to heal.
We're all part of everything. Everything is energy. So we're everything that we see. Even if we're being cruel to someone, we are. It's us. You know, we are harming ourselves. And I mean, it's just that we're all in this one big energy force, which is, when you feel it, it's hard to articulate the words, and I think that's where the power is, in the power of love, obviously, which is what I'm all about, you know, and it starts with going within. So, I mean, how do you, looking back on your writings and then knowing yourself today, Are you living your truth? Do you love? I mean, I know you are, but I want to ask. are you, you know, do you truly love yourself just as you are?
I'm much, much better than I've ever been. I'm happier than I've ever been. I am in a wonderful relationship. I love the work that I do. I feel in balance for the most part. I feel like I've integrated a lot of the pain and the loss in my life and turned it to insight to the best of my ability. So I do appreciate myself. And I also realize that self-love and self-appreciation has nothing to do with the ego. When I say that right. I appreciate myself as a part of God, mm-hmm. as something unique and extraordinary, the way you are unique and extraordinary. It's not putting oneself above anyone else, and that's what a lot of people don't understand about self-love. They think that it's conceited or it's selfish or it's just unbecoming to acknowledge yourself and esteem yourself, when in fact, until we do that, we can't love another person because we haven't, our reservoir isn't full. We have to fill right. that reservoir from within first, you know, before we can recognize the beauty of other people and also be generous without conditions, you know, and mm-hmm. loving without conditions.
Right. That's huge, is giving, because it does fill you up with love, but there's more to it than that. It's a sacred exchange of, yeah. So, well, we need to take our last break, everyone. I'm really enjoying this time with you, Mark. So everyone, stay with us. Don't go away. We'll be back in a moment.
Take a journey to a place of the divine love within with Deborah Beauvais on the Love by Intuition show, Monday through Friday at 6 p.m. and 6 a.m. Eastern. Our message is love in the purest form. The light within us all is a guide to recall our beginning, to learn to love self and humankind, and to feel the higher power of our own divinity. To attract love, one needs to be love. Come join us and step into this glorious vibration called love.
Are you searching for a way to help create global change? Dream Vision 7 Radio Network's vision is to have an eclectic group of radio hosts dedicated to educating, enlightening, and helping humankind with positive messages and tools that enhance lives using different modalities and programs. If you would like to join our team and help illuminate the universe, call Deborah at 508-226-1723 or Deborah at dreamvision7radio.com.
Delight your kids with an enchanting journey by reading the Paper Doll Kids children's book by Deborah Beauvais and Janine Sullivan. There's even a catchy tune, Kids for Love Song, produced by Bob Sherwood and sung by kids just like yours. The story weaves around seven paper dolls flying around the world doing good deeds as they bring important attention to our endangered animal friends. There's even a magical ring with a universal message. Kids become interested in service projects, action through compassion, and planting seeds that nurture positive change. The Paper Doll Kids and Kids for Love Song are a production of the Kids for Love Project. Get the book now on Amazon Kindle and the song on CD Baby or iTunes.
Why are we here? How can we be happy? Questions asked from millennials to boomers. Crappy to happy. Sacred stories of transformational joy answers them using true stories of grit, grace, and love. James Redfield, author of The Celestine Prophecy, wrote in the foreword, "This book is a seminar about emerging truths and offers grounded solutions through the art of the comeback." Dr. Bernie Siegel, a contributing author, wrote, "Bodies die, but spirits and consciousness survive and recycle." So, grab some tissues, open your book, and prepare to cry and laugh till it heals. Crappy to Happy by Reverend Ariel Patricia and Kathleen O'Keefe Cannabis. Available from Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and booksellers worldwide.
It's a child's job to play, to learn, and to have fun. It's an adult's job to keep them safe. Did you know that 1 in 4 girls and 1 in 6 boys will be sexually abused before the age of 18? Every day, families enter the Children's Advocacy Center because a child's courage to tell someone what happened to them. Keeping our children safe starts with a conversation. This is Michelle Aranger, Executive Director of the Children's Advocacy Center. Learn more on how to keep your child safe. Visit cacofbc.org. This message made possible by the Fall River Rotary Club.
This is Dream Vision 7 Radio Network, uniting mankind with universal love. Our shows are created from the heart, bringing each listener to a place of divine enlightenment. Breathe, relax, and enjoy. Let life flow.
Everyone, we're talking about Mark Matousek's book, the number one book, first book, should I say, Sex, Death, Enlightenment, A True Story. And when you purchase that, you should also purchase When You're Falling, Dive. That's another one of his books that's excellent, Lessons in the Art of Living. So check that out. Mark, let's go back to Mother Mara. Describe her and your experience through her in a little more depth.
Sure. As I said earlier, I met her unexpectedly. I knew nothing about her, which is good because my doubting, skeptical mind didn't have a chance to get in there and sort of prepare and sabotage what had happened. Mother Mira is an Indian adept or saint. Some people call her an avatar. It doesn't matter what you call her. She's an extraordinary and enlightening being who gives darshan, which is her silent blessing, all over the world in normal times. And right now is doing it every day online. And it's a simple ritual. She touches your head on the side, at which time she's tuning in to energy meridians in the body. It's all very esoteric, and I don't understand it. And then she releases your head, and you look into her eyes for a moment, and then she's doing a different kind of work, which is explained in Sex, Death, Enlightenment, and also in the books that have been written about Mother Mira. And that's what she does. It's completely silent, which is a huge blessing, and it's also very profound. You know, many spiritual traditions say that the highest teaching happens in silence. And I do believe that that's true because the mind doesn't have anything to latch onto or argue with. It really is just about presence. The other thing that I love about Mother Mira, so the first time I met her, we stayed for a week with her in Germany, and I have then lived with her for periods of time, for months at a time, over the years. But what I love about her particularly is that she is not a guru. She doesn't see herself as someone with disciples. She has no rules. There's no dogma. It's very much about the sacred feminine and all-inclusive vision of spirituality. So that when I do see her, whenever I see her, it's as if I saw her yesterday. You know, there's that kind of intimacy. But I'm not attached to her physical being. And that's something that she emphasizes all the time is, you know, don't attach to this body. It's not about that. Nor is it about giving your power away to someone. It's about recognizing the divine in yourself by being in the presence of someone whose pilot light, you could say, is just much, much brighter. And that's the beauty of it. There's no hierarchy or sense that you need to be obedient to anything. In fact, when people want to come move to Germany and give their lives to her, she says, no, go home, take care of your family, you know, pray to God. She's not at all possessive, which a lot of spiritual teachers are, in fact. And so that has really worked for me because I'm not a joiner. I don't particularly like groups, and I don't particularly like authority. She's been an ideal kind of a totem for me, kind of a symbol of what's possible in human evolution.
Right. So through the culmination of everything that you searched for and everything that you experienced and signed up for and all, when you got to her at the end of the book, when you got to her and stayed, you know, the room, I guess, below her, the experience you had, everything came together finally, and what I related to was all the angst and the anxiety of going to see her that time. You know, I've experienced something similar, and it's almost like things start to happen that are undescribable and unbelievable, mysterious, as you say. And then afterwards, it all comes together and you understand why you were so stressed or anxious to see, because you knew, in essence, at some level, that there would be astronomical awareness of what really brought you to where you are today, or what happened back then, and how you needed to let the child out. Can you speak to that for a little bit?
That was a profound experience. I was sitting in my room underneath Mother Mira's quarters in her house in this little village, and I heard a voice in my head. This is exactly what happened. I heard a voice in my head saying, "Stop typing." As I was writing, I was working on something. And I ignored it, and I kept typing. It said again, "Stop typing." I ignored it again, and then my keyboard froze on my computer. it did. It froze on my computer. I couldn't type. I'm sitting there, and all of a sudden I felt sort of dripping into the... this is how I would describe it. It was like honey or something warm dripping over the top of my head. And as it was dripping, I felt myself go into a very deep state. And then Mother Mira walked in the room in my inner vision, and she said, "Remember that I love you." And then I proceeded to have this horrible experience of remembering childhood trauma, and it went on and on, and it was really hard. And what I saw in this vision was the thing that was blocking me on my spiritual path was a fear of being a child, because the experience of being a child in my life had been, you know, traumatizing and so painful. But that until I could be as a child, in other words, surrender and bring beginner's mind and bring trust to not only Mother Mira but to spiritual practice in general, I wouldn't be able to move forward on the path. You know, I was always going to be holding on to this terror of giving up control. And until I did that, nothing was going to change. And that was one of the most profound experiences of my life, and mm-hmm. one for which I'm deeply, deeply grateful.
Mm. So do you find yourself now older but still, you know, connecting with your inner child and letting that child out? Because I have to say that some of us, and I include myself in that, you become so serious at times and not allowing yourself to be giddy or you know, and a lot has to do with the experiences in your life. But when you're able to do that, mm-hmm. when you're able to see that as a gift, in a sense, not a gift in what the average person would think, but a gift, because when you're there in that space, you have arrived to freedom. You feel free, you feel light, you feel joyful. But that's a journey to get to that place. So I don't know where I started with that, but
It is a journey. It's a journey of trust, essentially, because, I mean, a child has to feel safe enough to play.
Yes.
And so for me, it really hinged on trust, mm-hmm. and the belief that I was loved as I am, that I belonged as I am, all things that I certainly didn't feel as a young person. And it was then that I felt myself lightening up, as you say, because you're not sort of contracted and clenching, holding on to control out of fear. There's this feeling of being well, and all things being well as mm-hmm. they are. And I had never experienced that in my life, anything close to a sense that things were as they are meant to be. That was a completely new concept for me. And it did help me let go and lighten up and feel more childlike in my life. It's a Marilyn Robinson, in one of her novels, a novel called Gilead, talks about a second innocence. You know, you have one innocence as a child, which is the child, you know, being a naive child who hasn't had a lot of experience. But then there's a second innocence that you earn. And you earn it through letting go of your of beliefs and attachments, and you learn it through trust. And so I feel like I've come into a second innocence, and it's something that I cherish.
That.
It's really precious to me.
I like that, Mark. Well, we're down to like 1.5 minutes, and so. In a sentence or two, what would you like to, I mean, there's so much richness to everything that you have shared. What would you like to leave the listeners with?
The thing I'd like to say, Deborah, is that self-inquiry in a time like this is an absolutely transformative practice, the act of asking questions. And doing it through writing is something that my work has become devoted to, writing to Awaken, which you mentioned earlier. And I also have a community called the Seekers Forum, which people can find, theseekersforum.com. And we're doing a weekly writing practice, a self-inquiry writing practice that people are having fantastic results from. So, of course, I'd love people to join us if they would like, but if not, try to do some introspective journaling and ask yourself deep questions, particularly in a time like this, because you can make so much progress and have so much insight in a moment when we need it the most. So that's what I would like to leave people with.
I love it. Well, it's been an honor to have you, and I know that I'll have you back again. So everyone, thank you, Mark, so much. Everyone, pass the show around. Listen to it again. It's full, and there's so much that you can grasp from that and help yourself on your own path and journey. So listen again and share, and know that you are loved. Whether you believe it or not, you are loved. And if you just start to believe a little tiny bit that you are loved regardless, then you open up your heart and you start on your path, and it's a path to joy and hope. I think hope is so key for all of us right now, and even going in the future, hope is everything. There is always hope. And with that, until we meet again, au revoir.
Are you seeking a clearer path to love? Then tune in to the Love by Intuition show next week. All designed to your highest good. To contact Deborah Beauvais, owner of Empowered Connections, call her at 508-226-1723. That's 508-226-1723. Or link on to loveByIntuition.com. Remember, we are all one, and we are all part of the miracle of love.
This is Dream Vision 7 Radio Network, uniting mankind with universal love. Our shows are created from the heart, bringing each listener to a place of divine enlightenment. Breathe, relax, and enjoy. Let life flow.